Where's Bios? Okay. You know, after Bios spoke, I felt so sad that I just felt like just tearing my paper and walking up to Pastor Kojua saying that I will leave. And I can invent 1,000 excuses as well. After all, I'm a Nigerian. But I also realized that Pius is a teacher, and teachers are very difficult people. A teacher called one of his students to his office and said, if you are as you are now, if you find a lion chasing you, what do you do? He said, you will run and climb a tree. Then the teacher said, what if the lion climb the tree too? He said, then he will jump from it and jump into a river. The teacher said, what if the lion jumps into the river? The teacher said, Abba, are you on my side or on the side of the lion? You know, for all the things we say about Nigeria, Nigeria is an incredible country. A Nigerian, an American, and a British, they were in a ship, and the devil just appeared. And he said, throw anything into the water. If I can find it, I'm going to eat you up. The American thought he was clever. He threw a pin into the water. The devil found it, and as you imagine, hurt up the American. The British took a coin, threw it into the water. The lion, the devil, found the nickel and consumed. Nigeria looked at the devil, picked a sachet of pure water, poured it, and said, old boy, now me and you today, go find them. When this auditorium hosted platform for the first time exactly 1 year ago, Pastor Kwaju was a bachelor. But today, he is happily married, so in a way, change has come to platform. Therefore, I must begin by first recognizing our sister, Mrs. Toyin Oyemade. I also want to recognize those who have spoken before me. Mrs. Bolanle Austin Peters, who is doing a marvelous work at Terra Culture. Ms. Judy Smith, who continues to inspire the world on how to confront the crisis and sometimes scandals that come with leadership. And then my friend and brother, Professor Pius Adesanmi, who has refused to heed my call to come back home. Essentially because he believes that those of us at home eat too much yam and its derivatives. And he doesn't like eating yam, perhaps so that it will not stick to his mouth. I hope many of us read his last piece. I won't say more. Well, I have a message for you, Pius, wherever you may be in this hall. If you don't come home very soon, by the time you eventually decide and say, Ile Kokontagbe, what you may find left may be no more than a few tubers of yam. I also want to specially recognize Professor Patutomi, who I understand is upstairs, with whom I will also be spending the better part of tomorrow on a most worthy cause. Early in August this year, the Nigerian Breweries PLC, as part of its corporate social responsibility initiative, appointed 6 of us as a panel of judges to select winners at the Maiden Multinational Teacher of the Year Awards coming up on October 12th. There were 275 entries from 33 states of the country. And after a rigorous process that involves each of us marking all the entries, we will be interviewing the finalists tomorrow here in Lagos. As an aside, that experience of marking 275 strips of teachers across Nigeria has opened my eyes to the challenge of education in our country. But that is an issue for another day. Interestingly, I'm the only one among the six judges not professing anything, as other members are respected professors drawn from the academic community. On the day of our inauguration, the Nigerian Bureau's officials gave each of us a piece of paper to write the name of who we felt should chair our panel. They didn't appoint a panel for us. Without a card reader, we all voted for Professor Patu Tomi, for whom members of my generation keep learning. And finally, we also have in our midst the Bishop of Sokoto, who remains affectionately to many Nigerians as Father Puka, a cleric who cannot stop shooting elephants. Bishop Kuka knows what I am talking about. Pastor Poju, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, according to Mark Twain, there are two types of speakers: those who get nervous and those who are liars. So let me begin with a confession. Despite this being my fourth time on platform, I feel rather nervous to be on this podium today. I don't know why Pastor Kwaju keeps inviting me, but I know that given the experience of the past few weeks, he will think twice before doing so again. First, he sent me an SMS asking for the topic I would like to speak on, and it took more than five reminders for me to give him one. And then after that, I must have sent him about six different messages as I kept changing the topic. And right now, I cannot even remember the last one I gave him. But I can remember the first one. And the title is "By This Time Tomorrow." I gave that topic because I see so much gloom and despondency around me. And I thought I'd just come here and share the biblical story of the siege in Samaria, when God, within 24 hours, changed the fortune of a city. The story can be found in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 6 and 7. The idea was to raise the hopes and aspirations of our young men and women, who are the most vulnerable group in our country today, that notwithstanding the circumstances of the moment, it will be all right. I just didn't want to come here to join the wailing wailers. I want to inspire hope. However, while I felt that it would be nice to be a motivational speaker on a day such as this, I was also mindful of the fact that I might unnecessarily be raising the expectations of a generation that has been betrayed again and again. In any case, Pastor Kwaju invited me here to speak and not to preach. Nevertheless, the more I reflected on the story of the siege on Samaria, the more fascinated I became by it, especially considering that those I think are the real heroes in the narrative are usually given no more than footnotes. It is almost always about Prophet Elisha, the King Ahab, the desperate widows who were feeding on the carcasses of their children, and the disbelieving officer who carried the king's scepter. But for me, without the lepers who came up with a logical statement that spurred them into action, the situation would probably have remained the same. Hemmed in by the enemy camps with no possible means of survival, the city whose people had provided them with handouts was under siege. So for the lepers, it was time for an honest evaluation of the situation at hand. This was the conversation in the biblical account in verses 3 and 4 of chapter 7 of 2 Kings. And I read, "Now there were four men with leprosy at the entrance of the city gate. They said to each other, 'Why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now, therefore, come, let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall only die. If we stay here, we die. That was the outcry of the lepers. While others had settled for cannibalism, the lepers came to a more rational conclusion. They would soon die from famine if they stayed in the city, because even if any food became available, they would certainly be the last to receive it. So they decided that their chances were better if they surrendered to the Syrians. Of course, those familiar with the story knows that God went ahead of the lepers, causing a supernatural sign to descend on the enemy's camp. As the rest, as they say, is history. If we stay here, we die.